Hello and welcome to this video introduction to the game scheme at the Danish Film Institute. My name is Simon Løvin. I'm commissioning editor at the game scheme, and I will do this video introduction to cover the basic questions of what the video scheme is and how it operates. And this is meant as a supplement to, of course, our website. And also, we usually make meetings in relation to all application deadlines. So I encourage you to also visit one of those if possible. I will try to cover a lot of the basic questions, like the what is the game scheme? Who can apply for the game scheme, what kind of games can be supported, how is the assessment functioning, how do we evaluate projects, what are the criteria for the assessment, and what can you apply for, and how do you apply, and how to find help if this presentation is not enough. It's an informal presentation, as you can see. I also use some of the pictures from previous supported projects. If you want to know more about them, they're all described on our website. Okay. So, before we go into the details, I will just let you know that the game scheme has existed in more than 10 years. And here you see our staff, the daily staff. It is me as the commissioning editor that follows the project in detail and is a part of the assessment. It is Mikkel Thomasen as producer, who is doing the producer assessment about resources and the framework around the project. And it's Karen Jacobsen, who is the coordinator and is the one receiving applications and paying out installments and a lot of other things. So let's dive into it. What is the game scheme? Well, first of all, it's really important to understand that the game scheme is a cultural support scheme. That means that all of our funding comes from the Cultural Ministry, and our criteria and our way of thinking is about games as a cultural product. Of course, we do want an audience for our projects, and we certainly don't mind that projects become huge commercial successes, but it is not in our core purpose. So, to talk about that purpose, I have written it there. The purpose of the DFI's funding is to promote Danish digital games as a cultural bearing medium and to strengthen the cultural qualities of digital games for play and learning. The funding shall improve conditions for realizing and disseminating original Danish game projects with the aim of contributing to the quality and diversity of the overall range of Danish digital games. So you can see there's emphasis on the cultural qualities. I will elaborate on that later. We cover both play, entertainment, and learning, like games specifically made for learning. And we have a focus on the original content and the original, the fresh ideas. And as you can see, we contribute to the quality and diversity, which means that we also try to fund games that would otherwise not be possible to produce if they represent an interesting and important new expression. The framework for the game support is something called Filmaftalen, or the Film Agreement. It's a political agreement in the parliament. And this states that we, as the Danish Film Institute, should spend at least 10 million Danish kroner per year. And in 2021, we have a budget around 12 million. And these money are for development and production and launch of games, and also for something called game promotion, which is more about activities in the in the game industry. So. So, if we look at what kind of game we can support, actually, that's pretty broad. Of course, we are talking digital games, but we can support all target groups. We have no limitations in terms of genre or platform. Of course, if you are experimenting with new genres and new platforms, we do consider if there is a possible audience for that. And then we have a focus on interaction and gameplay, of course. That means that sometimes some projects are not game enough to us. I mean, this is grayscale, of course, that can go from the non-interactive, let's say, digital picture book to a game. But our focus is when the interactivity is an important part of the experience. We cover both entertainment, creativity, and learning. Creativity is also very much a gameplay when it comes, especially to younger children. And if you look at who can apply for the game scheme, well, the applicant has to be a Danish production company. That means there has to be a Danish registered company. It can be a company of any of the official forms. And if, to supplement that, it's also that the applicant has to make it likely that the game actually is producible by the resources present, and that it can reach its audience. And the applicant has to document that they have the needed technical and creative competences present in the project. And then the question is, how is the assessment done? Well, first of all, the project is evaluated by an editorial board of three persons. It's the Game Schemes commissioning editor, that is me, and two external game experts. So, and to supplement that, there's a producer assessment where it's more about the framework and the resources around the project. And the project are at first evaluated from the application material. So, secondly, some selected projects they will be invited for a conversation with the editorial board to kind of expand on the application. And if a project is decided to be supported, typically there will be a period of clarification and adjusting. If a project is not supported, it will get a written argument why it didn't receive support. And for supported projects, in the end, this support is granted by the board of directors of the Film Institute. So that's a formal process that the project has to go through. If we look at the very core of what the editorial board does, then first we look for the game concept. Is it a clear idea? I mean, has it reached a good level of clarification? Does it contain cultural qualities? I will explain that later. And does it have clear original elements? So basically, we have to have, even in early development, a pretty good idea of what is the intention about the user experience of this game. So. And secondly, we also look about the ability to actually produce the game. Does it have realistic goals? Does it have the cross-disciplinary team that it takes to make a game? And is there what you could say demonstrated qualities that could be, of course, earlier productions, or it could be work already done on the project that shows great potential. So this is kind of the first look at it. So but the more detailed question is when we discuss in the editorial board the criteria, and these are the criteria that we use to prioritize which projects should have support. There are four of those, the four main criteria. It's the cultural value, it's the originality, it's the implementation, or you could say the quality of the implementation, and it's responsibility. I will expand on all four. I will just clarify the last one first, the responsibility. This is meant as responsibility towards the user or the player. And it is it's a question mainly about, for instance, handling of personal data, transparency in the business model, questions like that. Is it suitable for its target group? But still, it's rare that this is a problem in the applications we see. But if a project has, for instance, not considered how to do moderation in a children's game with online chat, then we would reject it based on the lack of responsibility towards the player. Okay. The cultural value is a more of a tricky parameter. So therefore we have done some work to clarify what we mean about this in this context. So this is not by any means a universal standard, but it's the standard that we use to saying that these are ways to gain cultural value in our system. So I will explain the four aspects that can count as cultural value. If you take it from below, first of all, if it has specific Danish relevance to Danish culture, language, history, geography, then that in itself is a cultural value. It can also be the game's social qualities, if it somehow succeed in creating positive social interaction and new ways of communication between players, then that can be seen as a cultural value in our context. Then if it's a learning game, the learning intention in itself is a cultural value. Of course, we also have to believe that it's a better way of learning because it's a game than using the traditional means of learning. And then the last one is the aesthetic qualities. This is about the artistic vision and the artistic innovation and the projects that actually challenge what we expect from a video game. These are four quite different ways to gain cultural value, and as it says, you have to be remarkable in at least one of these four aspects. If I continue to originality, that criteria is the question of, does the game has a clear own identity? Does it have, you know, apparent original elements? This can be, of course, in many areas. It can be in the storytelling, it can be in the gameplay, it can be in the audiovisual style. There's many possibilities, but it has to be clear and identifiable so we can point it out. And that will also mean that in the end, this game will stand out in relation to the existing games on the market. And then the last one, which is a little special in this context of originality, that it has to be engaging and challenging. And by that, this is meant as a counter, because you can make something very original, very special, and it can become, for instance, weird or strange. But if you have a highly original concept, it still has to be engaging for the player, and represent, you know, a challenge that the player wants to engage in. So the last one, implementation, or the quality of implementation. Here we look at basically the craft, that the project should represent the highest level of craft and design. And by highest level, we mean by the professional standard of Danish game development. And the cross-disciplinary competence should be present to realize the game. And then the goal of the phase that you're applying for should be relevant to the challenges that are to the game. So we usually say that the goal for a supported phase should actually focus on the largest risk or the largest unknown about that project. And then there has to be a trustworthy, a believable plan for how to finalize and realize and publish your game. So, then the question comes, what can you apply for? And I will dive into that. We have different types of support in different phases throughout the whole production and development. So we have development. We have two types or two levels of development support. One where the support is up to 100,000 Danish kroner, and then we have another level of development where you can apply for more than that. I will explain how in a second. And then we can fund production, which means that it has to be finalized. And we can also fund a launch of the game, but only to the games that are already funded for production. We also have the type of funding called game promotion, which is more about meetings and networking and publications and other things in relation to game development that I will not cover in this context, but you can of course always call or send a mail to ask about that. Okay, so let's look at the different types in more detail. Well, if you apply for funding up to 100,000 kroner for early development, that would typically be for a development phase that has the purpose of unfolding and demonstrate a game idea. And to do that, you have to have a clearly described game concept. And the result of the phase would typically be a prototype that demonstrates some essential aspect about the game. That what that can be is different from genre to genre. If your game is very much based on mood and atmosphere, it would typically be something that represents the visual style and the audio style and so on to get that mood. So you can see this is an essential quality about this specific game. If you're doing a online multiplayer game with a complex technical setup, it might actually be more of a technical prototype showing that you can solve the concrete issues about server communication or whatever that might be the main challenge. So this would typically be what you apply for to do. but it can also be other products that kind of unfold the game idea and makes it ready for the production of the vertical slice later. If you're applying for more than 100,000, then you would apply for a development phase that will result in a finished part of the game that can be tested in a playable version, in the final expression, and the final technical solution. So that is another way of saying that the goal for a phase like this has to be a vertical slice, or sometimes called a demo, but we call it a vertical slice to emphasize that it is done in the depth in terms of final expression and technical solution. If you apply for more than 100,000 for development, you have to already have produced a prototype. And again, a prototype is something that shows something essential about the game. But of course, the prototype can be done in other technical solutions or in simpler way or only focusing on specific aspects. But it has to be there. Otherwise, you will have to apply for a lesser amount and earlier development. Then we go for production. It's a phase that has to lead to the finalization of the game in a full version that is ready for publication. And the game has to be made in a Danish language version. And to do so, you have to have a vertical slice, as I talked about before, and you also have to have a consistent launch plan about how you want to publish your game, through which channels and by what activities. The goal of the phase is, of course, the finalization and the publication. And typically, production support will be followed up by a launch support. And in that, there has to be a launch activities which is targeted towards Denmark. Okay, so how do you apply? First of all, the relevant documents are on our website. There are the application template that you have to use, and there's template for budget and financing plan. But you have to go to the website, and in the application template, in the end of that document, there's also a description of all the different parts that you need. So let's have a look of what that entails. Well, first of all, application can only be delivered or sent in by the 3 yearly deadlines for applications. So you have to hit one of those. Applications, they can be written in both Danish or English, depending on what your needs are. And prototypes and vertical slices, they have to be a part of the application as video documentation. The technical setup of trying to run all the different prototypes is really difficult. We tried that. And anyway, the risk is too big that we are focused on the wrong things. So it's better that you do your video documentation of your prototype, and you're welcome to make a commentary to guide our focus in watching the video documentation of prototypes and vertical slices. Here are all the different parts of the application. It's quite a lot, but basically it's also just a way to pin out the different aspects that we need to get covered. So it looks like a lot of appendices. It's a strange English word. But you could also view this in a simpler way, and I tried to clarify that by doing some grouping, saying, well, of course, the first one is the application template, and it's also just to give us the core data. So, but if you look at the main part of the application, well, the first four from the synopsis to the one pager and the design document and the visual, like the examples of visual expression and overview of technical solutions, it's basically answering the question, what is the game? So what is the game? It's a description of the game that takes different forms here. And certainly, especially in the synopsis, it's also, and why is this interesting? So this is also, especially in synopsis, for you to point out, you know, why, what are the special qualities about that game that makes it noteworthy and also suitable for support? So what is it? Why is it interesting? And the next five, from the project status to the financing plan, it's basically answering the question, what does it take to do what you are applying for? So, you know, where are you now? Where are you going? What's the time schedule? What's the resources needed to do that? And where do you find these resources to be able to carry this through? So the 11 and 12 target group and your plan for finalization and distribution, it's basically about the possibility of the game to reach its audience. Like, how will it do it, and what is the audience, and how will you meet it, and can it be expected to reach a larger audience? Then the last three ones, it's more about the preconditions for doing what you're doing. You have the rights, you have the people that are described in CVs. These are quite an important part of the application, so please do them specifically for application of this type. So it's all about game development. Also, please note, if you just say you worked on a project, what role did you have on that project? And also, CVs should include a description of the applying company. So, and then, of course, very important, even though it's the last one, if there is a prototype or a demo, there has to be a short description, and that short description also has to be followed by the video documentation of the prototype. This is the application format for development. It's more or less the same when it comes to production, not exactly, but I would just point out the few differences. First of all, we kind of moved up the part about the documentation of prototypes, in this case, documentation of vertical slice, with the description and the documentation. And since by applying for production that you have a vertical slice, that vertical slice is the most important part of your application, that you actually can show the qualities of your game. Then we don't have a design document when it comes to applying for production, because basically your core design should kind of be unfolded in the vertical slice. But of course, if there are parts of the designs that are not implemented yet and or not exemplified yet, you have to make it clear in the production plan what are the new parts of the games that are coming to be added, and how do you plan to go about that? And then the number 10, the launch plan. Now you are working to finalize your game. So you should have a pretty concrete plan on how to meet your audience, by which channels and with what means and with what activities. So that was already quite a lot. I hope it was informative, but if you want to find further help, first of all, go to our website. The most important information is there. You can also contact the different people at the game scheme. Me, the producer Mikkel, and the coordinator Khan. You are welcome to send us questions, and just as a general recommendation, the more precise and concrete a question you can ask, the more precise and concrete an answer we can give. So try to be focused in your questions to us about the game scheme, and then of course we would love to help you. So. Well, I hope this was informative, and hopefully we will see your projects in the future. Thank you very much.